about KPFA's programming, community service, and how the station's policy decisions impact your community. Again, that's October 18th at the Grassroots House, 2022 Blake Street in Berkeley from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m.
You are listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is now 3:30 p.m. Stay tuned for a rude awakening.
Today on A Rude Awakening, I've got a packed show for everyone. I'll speak to the Oakland Institute's Honorata Mittal on jailed Ethiopian activist Pastor Omot Agua. Longtime Bay Area activist Francisco Herrera on Proposition F and Proposition I, the controversial housing initiative on the ballot in November. And Bay Area activist and radio commentator with Radio Venceremos, Miguel Perez, on the anniversaries of two Mexican massacres, the Tlatelolco Plaza student massacre in Mexico City, 1968, and the Yotzinapa student teacher massacre in the state of Guerrero last year. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. Stay tuned. On the line with me today, I have Honorata Mittal. Honorata Mittal is the executive director of the Oakland Institute, and they are the ones that broke the story on the Ethiopian activist who has been jailed and is facing trial. And he's facing trial because of trying to find some equanimity with the food issue in Ethiopia. Honorata, thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening.
Thanks, Sabrina, for having me.
All right. Now, as per the newsletter that was put out several weeks ago, Ethiopian authorities have arrested he's a World Bank translator, and his name is Pastor Omot Agua. And he's been doing this work for decades, probably all his life. Now, the authorities are trying to charge him and several others under the anti-terrorism law after detaining them for nearly 6 months. And the charge sheet refers to the food security workshop, which was organized by the indigenous rights groups and international organizations based in Ethiopia. And they're trying to brand this particular group meeting. It's just a meeting, not the groups themselves, but it's just the group meeting as a terrorist meeting. Shed some light on this situation for us, please.
Well, Sabrina, I think what is highlighted in this case where Pastor Omot and two other colleagues were arrested because they were going to attend, as you mentioned, a workshop organized by international civil society organizations, including Bread for the World, on food security. These activists who've been working around issues of land and the increasing food insecurity that is happening in Ethiopia, they were arrested by the Ethiopian government. They were held in jail. They've been held in jail for over 161 days without being charged, and now they're being charged as terrorists. Their act of terrorism is to be concerned about growing hunger and poverty of the indigenous populations who are being displaced from their lands, and those lands are being given away to foreign investors. This is also very symbolic of the overall repression and political oppression that you see in Ethiopia, where whether it is journalists, whether it's activists, civil society actors, either are living in exile or they're living behind bars. And it is this crackdown on political dissent that we are questioning and challenging, because Ethiopia, as we know, is one of the closest allies of the United States in Africa.
Oh, my goodness. Okay. Now, Pastor Omot, he's the Evangelical Mekene Yesus Church in Ethiopia's Gambela region, and he was an interpreter for the World Bank. I mean, why would the government see him as being a threat? I mean, there's people that are starving there. He's trying to help his people. He's a man of the cloth. I mean, where is this fear coming from, this unfounded fear?
Well, you know, it is really about Ethiopian government wanting to, you know, hide from the world what the impact of its so-called development policy is. So this development policy, which is based on attracting foreign investors, building large dams, is really built on displacement of the indigenous populations. And people like Pastor Omot have been trying to highlight the plight of the people. fact, when the World Bank's inspection panel was in Ethiopia, and this came about because the communities had asked the inspection panel that the World Bank's support for the Ethiopian regime is leading to displacement and increasing poverty among Ethiopians instead of the bank fulfilling its mission of ending poverty, he was a translator. So he was seen as a threat by the Ethiopian government, and in fact, even before he was arrested, he had reached out to many of us, including us at the Oakland Institute, saying that he had been receiving calls where he was scared. The calls had basically threatened him that he would be arrested, and he was very keen to leave the situation. And if you look at the clip that has been made available along with our alert, I mean, he says clearly it is not just that he's afraid of being arrested, he's afraid of torture. And that's what we have heard over and over again from people who have been detained, that the confessions that the government manages to get out of people are through torture in its prisons, such as Makalevi prison.
Mm-hmm, definitely. And the Ethiopian government has been, they are notorious for cracking down on activists and just being hard on the common man. I covered a story a couple of years ago regarding folks that have been displaced and they are being shipped out via these so-called employment agencies to these other countries and basically just being sold. It's like human trafficking. So the people that are there, that are still trying to live, they're basically starving as well. Is there any call by the UN? Has there been any type of international outcry about this? I mean, your newsletter that I was in receipt of, yours is the only one that's actually speaking about this.
Well, in case of Pastor Omar, several organizations from around the world have come together to actually ask for something to happen. They're putting pressure on the U.S. government, on the World Bank, as well as the EU.
Okay.
And these organizations include Human Rights Watch, Bread for All, Grain, ANIWA, Survival Organization, which is UK-based, including Development International, as well as the Oakland Institute. Because all of us have been working in Ethiopia. We have seen this kind of crackdowns that are happening. But also all of us know Pastor Omar personally.
Okay. All right. Well, the personal connection, there's nothing like it. That's for sure. And it's good to know that these other organizations are trying to get the word out. I definitely will be hitting Twitter myself, so just to get the word out about Pastor Omar. Where can people get more information? Now, you said that there was a video or audio piece where Pastor Omar is speaking. Is that correct?
That's correct. Well, people can find out more about the situation just by going on our website, which is oaklandinstitute.org. You know, the action alert is there, as well as a brief clip where you can listen to Pastor Omar himself. If you want to know more about what's happening and what issues Pastor Omar and other activists were engaged in around food issues, food insecurity, you can find all of our reports on our website.
All right. Oakland Institute, oaklandinstitute.org. Anurata Mitchell, Executive Director of the Oakland Institute. Thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening and bringing this horrible, horrible travesty to our attention. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Sabrina.
Switch gears just a little bit. We're going to talk about the housing crisis in San Francisco. And I think it's safe to say that a lot of folks pretty much are calling San Francisco a loss. I'm definitely one of them, but was contacted by the camp of Francisco Herrera. Francisco Herrera is a longtime activist. He is a cultural worker. Working to mesh all the different cultures in the San Francisco area, the Bay Area, the nation, and the whole world. And he's been at it for over 3 decades. Francisco Herrera, talk to us. Thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening. Talk to us about what's going on with these particular propositions, Proposition I and then Proposition F.
Thank you, Sabrina. Well, I'll just start by saying both propositions are the result of the community in San Francisco being tired of knocking on Mayor Lee's door and not getting results in terms of the horrible crisis of housing affordability that's happening, because a runaway housing market has been created with no morals. No, it's kind of like an addict on a binge. And so that's what's happening in San Francisco, and it's happening in the major cities of the world. It's almost as if you think of the world as one big city, and basically the corporate leaders have decided that certain areas of the world are their neighborhood, their gated community. And so the Bay Area has been determined by corporations, if we let them, that this will be their gated community. What it means is, if you don't make $200,000 a year or more, you are not welcome. Mm-hmm. And so starting with San Francisco, but moving to Berkeley, moving to Oakland, San Mateo, the other places of the Bay Area, basically what they're trying to do is create like a green zone in Iraq, you know, mm-hmm. where only a certain amount of people can get in and out. And, of course, servitude can get in and out. They come in to serve. Mm-hmm. And to give an example, San Francisco right now, more than half city employees cannot afford to live in San Francisco. They have to come out from outside. They've been displaced and pushed out. Some fallacy holders like to have us believe it's just a natural case of the free market, but they're just like I was taught in economics 101, there ain't no such thing as a free lunch. There ain't no such thing as a free market. Mm-hmm. And so, it's basically a zone where might makes right. So if I have $10 billion, then I have the permission to displace wherever I want and do whatever I want. Well, that's not the case. I'm sorry. You might have, just because you have a Ferrari that runs at 150 miles an hour does not give you the right to run that Ferrari at 150 miles an hour in the middle of lunchtime through a schoolyard.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And so, anyway, so mm-hmm. that big introduction to say people have been forced to create petitions in a legal format, and that's what Proposition F and Proposition I, mm-hmm. F as in fix the problem, and I as in I love San Francisco,
mm-hmm.
That's why they are now on the ballot for this election.
All right, now let me make sure we make this clear for our listeners. Proposition I would establish a temporary 18-month prohibition on the construction of any housing project larger than 5 units, and it would also prohibit permits for the demolition, conversion, or elimination of production, distribution, and repair use buildings.
That's correct.
And that includes structures of many business-related types, such as buildings for industrial, automotive, storage, and wholesale uses. The initiative would also grant exceptions for the construction of units to be used exclusively for affordable housing. That's Proposition I. That is Proposition I. Now, with Proposition F, now this is like the Airbnb initiative.
It's the people's initiative to regulate Airbnb, okay. just like in New York. Go ahead, Sabrina.
No worries. Why? Okay, so let's ask the rhetorical question, make sure we have everything clear for everybody out there in regards to Proposition F. Voting yes on Proposition F is against Airbnb. Voting no on Proposition F is in favor of businesses like Airbnb. Give us a description of what Proposition F is.
So basically, we're facing the most horrible housing crisis, and part of the problem has occurred because there's a natural stream where people sublet or rent out their rooms for a certain amount of period of time. Airbnb and other their businesses like this are platforms, electronic platforms, where people go through them to rent to other tourists. So what's happening in both Prop I and Prop F is that we, the working people of San Francisco, who decided that we are the developers and want to stay here, have created these two propositions to say we want a housing affordable to us, to the 300 teachers who cannot live in San Francisco and therefore cannot teach here, to the 2,700 children who are forced to live in cars, not just in the Mission, but people in the Sunset District and the Richmond District who have jobs who are being forced to live in cars and living rooms and are homeless now. So we are putting forth regulations to stop the luxury housing. Luxury housing projects need to halt for a second. And with Prop F, it's like, look, before you're renting out to tourists, we have to make housing stock for people who can live here, who work here, nurses, doctors, including doctors, students, teachers, you know, the rest of all of us. So that's what those two have to do, is stopping and regulating. It's so funny to me, Sabrina, all these people who love to talk about law and order hate to talk about rules and regulations, you know. And you can't have law and order without rules and regulations. We're facing a horrible situation right now, a burglary, just like Oakland is facing, because the economy, the so-called boom, has been nothing but a bomb for the working class. And so it really has been destroying our economy. And so, of course, you're seeing burglaries rise. You're seeing, you know, car break-ins. You're seeing the kind of things that you see when people start becoming desperate.
Right.
And that's
right.
The situation we're facing. And that's why Prop F and Prop I have been created by the people of San Francisco. And we're getting a lot of baloney from Airbnb, and those guys are putting in over $8 million into defeating Proposition F. And you know what the funny thing is? That regulation already exists in New York, in Los Angeles, in Texas, and other major cities.
Wow.
What we're proposing already exists. They just don't want to pay their fair share of what needs to be paid to make life good for everybody in San Francisco. So they're fighting tooth and nail for something that already exists in New York.
All right, so it's a ditto of what's happening in the major cities, and here in the country, here in the United States, and all over the world, just like you said earlier. And it's a very, very scary thing. I love how you made the correlation between law and order, as far as, you know, thefts, robberies, assaults, etc., and with the need for law and order to be enforced in regards to housing. Thank you for doing that. Thank you so much, Francisco, for doing that. Let me make sure we make this all clear for our listeners. Proposition F is the measure that would impose restrictions on private short-term housing rentals. It would restrict all such private rentals to only 75 nights per year and impose provisions designed to ensure such private rentals are paying hotel taxes and following city codes, so paying the fair share part that you mentioned, Francisco, earlier. It would also require guest and revenue reports from rental hosts and quote-unquote hosting platforms every 3 months. Et cetera, et cetera. You can all go to Ballotpedia. You can all go to Ballotpedia and get the information on these two propositions that are affecting housing in the city of San Francisco and affecting housing throughout the major cities here in the United States. Ballotpedia.com. We're running out of time. Francisco Herrera, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to my listeners, our listeners here at KPFA, in regards to this housing issue, because it's indicative of all of these cities, and the displacement is just, it's going to be astronomical in the next 5 to 10 years. Do you have any last words?
If we let it, it will be. But we are the developers, and we are going to develop the cities as we choose to do so. So let's get organized, folks.
I know that's right. And you can get in touch with Francisco Herrera. You are on Twitter as well, correct?
That's correct. And the folks can call 415-812-9362. Or peoplescampaign.net. They can reach us that way too.
All right. Thank you for that. Cultural workers. Happy to have you on our side. Thank you so much for being on AM Awakening.
Very much.
Interrupting all programs. international plan. In the fiscal shadow of the white right hand, the Nazi ideology is an urban Vietnam, giving daily exhibitions of murder.
And it was almost, it was over 40 years ago that the Tlatelolco Plaza massacre, student massacre, occurred in Mexico City. And it's been a year ago, as of last month, that the Ayotzinapa massacre happened in Guerrero State in Mexico, where 43 student activists, student teachers, or teacher students were disappeared and most likely murdered and killed. The correlations between these two horrible events are just, they're irreprehensible. It's just absolutely horrible, sad, and it keeps happening. On the line with me today is longtime activist and radio commentator Miguel Perez. Mr. Miguel Perez, thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening.
Hi, Sabrina. Nice to meet you, and I'm very glad to be with you.
Now, I know I'm mispronouncing the plaza, the Tlatelolco Plaza in Mexico City, so please correct me. But I wanted to talk about really very briefly, just bring to everyone's attention what happened, what has happened, what happened last year, and the correlations between the two. There seems to be this huge fear of young people acting out and letting their thoughts and feelings be known about how the government is treating their fellow man.
Yes. Talking about October 2nd, October 2nd is a very particular part of the history, of Mexican history. In 1968 was an amazing demonstration in Tlatelolco, the Tlatelolco Plaza. This is in Mexico City. And there was the, almost the beginning of the summer of 1968 with the International Olympic Games was happening in Mexico. So 10 days before, was in a huge concentration of students, universitarian students. And in some point, the police and the army, particularly the army, surrounded most of the students and started to shoot them. For those days, is they never know exactly the number of students who was shot and died, but it was 1,500 people detainee, and there was like 300 people disappeared in those days. So there was the reason are the confusion of the situation. It was economic crisis, was the student doing an uprising because was almost a dictatorship of the PRI, the Institutional Revolutionary Party, who ran the country for 70 years, and people start to question it a lot in the politics where they develop into the country.
Mm-hmm.
So that happened on October 2nd, 1968. So from then to now, every October 2nd is in a mobilization of masses to remember those who died in those days. Mm-hmm. And that happened last year. That happened last year in Guerrero with this group of students who want to become teachers.
Mm-hmm.
And the police and the army again. And this is, what, 60 years? Yeah, almost.
Almost 45 years later?
45 years later.
Mm-hmm, 46, 47.
With this 43 students. Who was disappearing, none of them, I think that, it was like a 10 that they saved their life. But again, the army, they surrounded and kidnapped them, and until now they are disappeared.
Okay.
Again, so many mobilization. This is a very important time in Mexican life. Mm-hmm. Mexican history. The quantity of people who are on the street asking for the disappearance is millions of people.
Mm-hmm.
Mexico City can see 200, 300, 400,000 people on the streets. And the government of Peña Nieto is very weak in this at this point. This is how the possibility to have a national massive insurrection. October 12th is called for the national strike. And the government, they don't have too much political space to give answers to the people. The economic crisis in Mexico today is worse than ever. They privatize everything. Water, all the resources, so many mines, open mines, completely out of the law, international law. And some part of the country is controlled by the drug traffickers. And people organize themselves. And they start to give them political answers in some way, and it's a civilian rebellion.
Okay, so I got to wrap it up really quick here. Mr. Miguel Perez, longtime activist and radio commentator with Radio Venceremos. Just to sum it up real quick, what happened back in 68 was being reflected a year ago with the student teachers staging their activism and doing their demonstrations when they were disappeared by with the help of the federal police and the drug cartel running the state of Guerrero, along with the mayor and the mayor's wife, who was also seeking the mayoral position. Miguel Perez, love to speak with you again, definitely in more detail about what's happening in Mexico, but we got to go. I truly appreciate your time. Thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening.
Thank you very much, Sabrina.
All righty. Thank you so much. We will definitely speak with you soon. And that does it for another edition of A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. Big thank you to all my guests, Ana Rada Mitzel, Francisco Herrera, and of course Miguel Perez, for giving their time. And speaking of giving, I must give out I Heart You, a big I Heart You to you, community, for donating to your community radio station. We made our goal. We made our goal. And because of you, we exist. We exist. Thank you so much. Also, you can still make a tax-deductible contribution online and get your hands on those amazing premiums that were available. And that's going to be for a limited time. The lovely Erica Bridgman is on the controls. I'll be back next Monday. Hard Knock Radio's up next. Have a great week, everybody.
Station Board candidate. The views expressed are not those of KPFA management or staff.
Hello, I'm Tom Voorhees, a longtime member, listener, and previous volunteer at KPFA and a candidate for the local station board. I will work to rescue KPFA and Pacifica back to its anti-war and Occupy-type grassroots community organizing spirit. I oppose breaking up the Pacifica network and the recent attempt by the existing local station board to prepare to withdraw from Pacifica. Pacifica needs to survive to help end the military-industrial complex and its disastrous worldwide impact. Please vote for me and the UnitedForCommunityRadio.org team of candidates, all dedicated to unfiltered news and public affairs clarity for informed action by all listeners.
For more information, go to elections.pacifica.org.